Assalamu alaikum. Today we are going to discuss a very important topic and very as well as common among the genital tract malignancies that we encounter is the ovarian malignancies. In our previous lecture, we have discussed about the benign tumors of ovary, and today we are going to discuss about the malignant tumors of ovary or the ovarian carcinoma. So ovarian malignancy, as you can see, it's a normal ovary, and if the ovarian malignancy or a cancer develops, it can present as an ovarian mass. The lifetime risk of developing an ovarian cancer in the general population is 1.4%. That is, it becomes to about 1 in 70. And the mean age of presentation is rather at an elderly age. It is around 64 years. It is more prevalent in higher income nation groups. And what could be the pathology for it is that in the higher income nation groups, which we come across is that there as well as the trend of obesity is more in those nations, as well as there are nearly parity. There are more cases of diabetes and obesity related complications. So as we will discuss further, these are all the risk factors of ovarian malignancy. So therefore, they may be the reason behind the higher prevalence in the higher income group nations. As we see also that in the white women, because of the same reasons, the risk is about 14 per 100,000, while in the Asian women, it is around 10 per 100,000. And the risk is around 3% under the age of 35 years. As was previously thought, and as the name indicates, we had an impression that the ovarian malignancy arises in the ovary. But now we have come across with further research that a large proportion of an ovarian cancer may in fact originate in the fallopian tube rather than the ovarian surface epithelium as was previously thought. So this is very important landmark in our diagnosis, in our management, in our prevention as well, as we will discuss further when we have come across about this thing. So women with hereditary cancer present early, the mean age of diagnosis of 54 years. This is also an important factor to consider upon the hereditary or genetic factor. So as I think you remember from your previous lectures of benign ovarian tumors, that there were three main types. Do you remember? Depending upon the histological features of the ovary. And it was a very easy thing, where just we remembered, keeping in view the epithelium of the ovary, then the stroma, and then the germ cell, isn't it? So these are the three histological main features which we come across in the ovary. Epithelium, its stroma, and its germ cells. And these were the three main histological sources from where the benign as well as the malignant transformation occurs. So the same is true for the malignant transformation as well. If you keep in your mind, then you are not going to forget about its classification. Again, the epithelial, the stroma, and the germ cells. So, and then we will discuss the further minute details of the epithelial tumors, the germ cell tumors, and the stromal, which is also known as the sex cord stromal tumors. So please don't forget, again and again, I want to revise, same in the case of the benign, as well as in the malignant, of epithelial, germ cells, and the sex cord stromal tumor. So same is the case with the malignant tumors in the ovary. So either they are the primary ovarian cancers, which are epithelial. Most of the time, 80% of the epithelial ovarian tumors, keeping in view the incidence, then the sex cord stromal and the germ cell. And also an important consideration we should, which we should always keep in mind, is that the ovary is also a common site for metastatic spread of tumors occurring in other parts of the body. So these were the main of the ovarian origin, but these are the tumors which are originating in the other parts of the body but have a metastatic spread to the ovary. And the therapy of, for the treatment of the management of the tumor, which is on the other side, and its management would lead to the definitely a resolution of the tumor in the ovary as well, because it is the metastatic site. So these are known as the Krukenberg tumors. The Krukenberg tumors are the ovarian metastasis associated with primary cancers of the colon, stomach, and breast. Here, the main site was not the ovary itself. The primary sites were either the colon, stomach, and the breast, but the metastatic spread was in the ovary. So management in these areas would lead to definitely the management itself at the ovarian site as well. I hope I'm clear with you now. Now let's see again about the ovarian tumor classification. So you see the surface epithelial cell tumors, the germ cell tumors, and the ovarian sex cord tumors, and the other are metastatic. And these are different regarding the frequency, the age group affected, and the further types. So we are going to discuss about now in detail. So this is a very important diagram and the view for you, that this is how you remember them and you will not forget. And this is how, these are the main subtypes of epithelial tumors again. Serous, mucinous, and endometrioid. These we are going to discuss further. Similarly, for the germ cell tumors, the further subtypes are mature teratoma. What was the... and the immature teratomas as well. So the mature teratoma, as you remember, it is one of the benign tumors, which is known as the dermoid cyst. Very good. And now today we are going to discuss about the immature teratoma, which is the malignant counterpart for it. The dysgerminoma, yolk sac tumor, choriocarcinoma, and embryonal carcinoma. These are all the types of germ cell tumors. For them, the age group is part of earlier. It is a, you see, a very younger age group they appear. 0 to 25 years of age, okay? Ovarian stromal tumors, the sex cord stromal can appear in all ages with the variable incidence, and the Krukenberg tumors. So please don't forget the main subtypes and then the further subtypes. And you will not forget, if you remember again, the benign one, we discussed in the benign one, the serous cyst adenomas and mucinous cyst adenomas. And their counterparts, serous cyst adenocarcinoma and mucinous cyst adenocarcinoma, as well as endometrioid and clear cell, these are their malignant counterparts. And similarly, among the teratomas, when we discussed, that was the dermoid cyst, the main one, which was the mature one. And now we have the immature in the malignant counterparts. And the granulosa cell tumors and the fibromas and tripomas, we have discussed their benign counterparts. And now we are going to discuss about their malignant counterparts. So have a close look at this diagram. So again, now this is the further subtypes for the epithelial ovarian tumors. These are either high-grade serous, and then endometrioid cell carcinomas, a clear cell, the mucinous, or the low-grade serous. So high-grade serous or the low-grade serous. Then after the serous, you should remember is mucinous. And the last but not the least is the endometrioid clear cell tumors. See again the same classification. High-grade, clear cell, endometrioid, low-grade serous, and the mucinous carcinomas among the epithelial ovarian tumor. This is for the epithelial ovarian tumors. For the sex cord stromal tumors, their further subtypes are granulosa cell tumors, sertoli lighting cell tumors, and the gynandroblastomas. So for the germ cell tumors, the further subtypes are, which are of the least incidence, about 10 per, equally the same incidence, like 10% for the sex cord stromal and 10% for the germ cell tumors, and 80% for the epithelial ovarian tumors. So among the further subtypes for the germ cell tumors, when we do their classification, we have dysgerminoma, endodermal sinus yolk sac tumor, teratomas, which would be the immature one, and the choriocarcinoma. So for this thing, for the subtypes of germ cell tumors, sex cord stromal, and epithelial ovarian tumors, you have to do a bit of the learning for them to remember their subtypes. So for the metastatic spread, there are the Krukenberg tumor. So now coming to the epithelial ovarian tumors, these can be benign, borderline, or malignant. And 10% of the epithelial tumors are the borderline ovarian tumors. Now let's see what are the borderline ovarian tumors. As the name indicates, they are a bit borderline among the benign and the malignant variants. These are the tumors which are well differentiated. So what is the feature which is different from the malignant one? It is that well differentiated and it is closer to the benign ones, because in the benign ones we have histologically well differentiated patterns. So is the case with the borderline tumors, where we have a well differentiated pattern. Some features of malignancy are there. There may be nuclear pleomorphism, cellular atypia, but keeping in view still that they are well differentiated. And the important thing is they do not invade the basement membrane. When they become malignant, they would invade the basement membrane. So for the borderline ovarian tumors, they can have the spread to other abdominal pelvic structures like peritoneum and omentum. They do not often recur following the initial surgery. This is a good sign for them, you see. And the majority are the serous tumors. So these are about the borderline tumors. Their spread, their recurrence, you should be having a knowledge about them, and that they are the serous ones. Now coming to the mucinous borderline ovarian tumors, they actualize from the appendiceal carcinomas of the low malignant potential. So they are from the appendiceal carcinomas. Rather, they have some of the time they would not have a ovarian or the ovarian origin. So they can be associated with pseudomaxima peritonei. This we discussed earlier also in the epithelial, the mucinous cyst adenomas, that where the mucinous material can get, after the rupture of the mass, it can get spilled inside the peritoneal cavity and can cause a source of chemical peritonitis with a pseudomaxima peritonei. Now coming to the high-grade serous carcinomas. These are high grades and account about 75% of the all epithelial ovarian variants. Mucinous and endometrioid tumors are less common, and followed by the clear cell carcinoma. So this would be the incidence. The highest of the incidence among them is of the high grade serous. Then coming to the mucinous and endometrioid variants, and followed by the clear cell carcinomas. So for the high-grade serous tumors, the important characteristic feature is the seminoma bodies. This is very important. Remember it. This you are going to get mostly in your MCQs as well. And this knowledge you should mention about the high-grade serous tumors, because it is pathognomic of them to have a seminoma bodies, which are rings of calcification, and histologically they appear. For the mucinous carcinomas, which can appear as pseudomaxima peritonei, as I told you earlier, that these can be causing the like you see, this is a gelatinous material as of causing some chemical peritonitis, and this is the gut loops. If the tumor gets structured, this is the feature they can produce inside the abdominal cavity, which we label as pseudomaxima peritonei. For the endometrioid carcinomas, as the name indicates, where they have an origin from the endometriosis, so they have a link with an endometriosis. Or rather, you can say the patients with endometriosis can have a risk of developing an endometrioid carcinoma. So these are similar in histological appearance to the endometrial cancer as well. Okay, and they are associated with endometriosis in approximately 10% of cases, and also have a synchronous separate endometrial cancer in 10 to 15% of cancer. So with the word endometrioid, two things you should also keep in mind, that they have a relation with endometrial cancer. Secondly, they have a relation with endometriosis. I think you will not forget now. Endometrioid, meaning endometriosis, and endometrial cancer as well. So these are the variants with it. They tend to be well differentiated. So it means of low malignant potential, and are associated with a better survival than high-grade serous carcinomas. Their feature of being well differentiated will keep them in a low malignant potential. Now coming to the clear cell carcinomas, the clear cell carcinomas can also arise from endometriosis. They're characteristically histologically characterized by clear cells, and much like the renal cell, cancer as well. Now remember that clear cell carcinoma is a, it's a general term. It's a general term among the malignancies, and the clear cell carcinomas are not only confined to the ovarian tissue. Clear cell carcinoma can arise in any part of the body, in any organ of the body. This is a histological feature. Clear cell, as the name indicates, is the histological features, and can arise in any other organ of the body as well. And always remember that clear cell carcinoma, I think you have more knowledge than me, in other parts of the body as well, it is of higher malignant potential. So same is in the case in the ovarian clear cell carcinoma, where it is of higher malignant potential. The other variants can be high-grade pelvic carcinomas. This is other than the epithelial. We have finished with the epithelial variant, where we discussed about the high-grade serous, the mucinous, the borderlines, the clear cell and the endometrioid. Now the coming to another variant, this is the high grade pelvic carcinomas. Most high grade pelvic serous carcinomas present with advanced disease involving either the ovary, fallopian tube, or the peritoneal surfaces. And why we are discussing it here? Because it is often impossible to establish the anatomical site of the origin. So it is the thing that we are afraid of, that we are not, most of the time it becomes impossible for us to establish the anatomical site of the origin. Maybe it's not the ovarian in origin, but they are in the pelvis, confined to the pelvis. So the origin can be from the fallopian or the peritoneal surfaces as well. So assigning the primary tumor site is of clinical importance regarding the behavior, prognosis, and the treatment of these tumors. Now coming to the BRCA mutations, this is I think very much in now and have been previously as well, BRCA mutations. Women with BRCA mutations who have undergone reducing prophylactic bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy suggest a fallopian tube precursor lesion for the high-grade pelvis serous carcinomas. This was the thing we discussed in the first or the second slide as well, that our now modern research has led us to the conclusion that in addition to the ovarian as a primary site, there can be the fallopian tube precursors in other ovarian as well as pelvic carcinomas, which has also been found in the BRCA mutation. So this is very important. These precursors are also called serous tubal intraepithelial carcinomas. Serous tubal intraepithelial carcinomas. These are characterized by the mutations in the tumor suppressor gene, which is the P53 gene, and in the secretory cells of the distal fallopian tube. So endometriosis-associated ovarian carcinomas are usually of endometrioid or clear cell histological type. This is, again, I would like to emphasize that which are the endometriosis-associated, they mostly have endometrioid tissue or the clear cell variant in the histology. The origin of these tumors involve for the endometrioid tumors mutations in the different genes rather than the P53 gene. As the P53 was involved with the BRCA ones, and these genes are rather not involved, and these are mostly involved with the endometrioid carcinomas. The clinical distinction between high-grade pelvic serous carcinomas and other histological subtypes is important now, because the differences in the disease progression, response to chemotherapy, and prognosis we have to go on with. So this is therefore we are discussing about histological subtypes, because we are not going to be helped if we are not aware of the histological subtypes, because we are not going to be able to have a good disease progression response or response to chemotherapy and a follow-up for the prognosis as well. As I told you before also, that the endometrioid, mucinous, clear cell, and the borderline, and the low-grade serous ovarian carcinomas, they mostly arise from the inclusion cyst of the ovarian surface epithelium, as the name indicates. And endometriosis as well, and which give rise to neoplasms that are distinctly ovarian in origin. This is an important site. Now, as of the pelvic, or the serous tumors, I told you before in the previous slides, this is about the tumors which are typically of the ovarian epithelial origin. And these include the mucinous, endometrioid, clear cells, and the borderline and low-grade serous carcinomas. These are of mainly the surface, ovarian surface epithelial origin. Don't get confused about this, that just it's a demarcation we are trying to make. We are trying to make about the serous variants which can arise from the pelvic other structures or pelvic serosal surfaces as well, and the ovarian variants as well. there can be confusions sometimes which are arising when the masses have diffusely spread, and then to mark out the origin would be quite difficult. But if you have the histological, after the biopsy, the histological variants with you, then maybe you are able to get back to the origin when you come out with these histological subtypes, and then you can a bit of them well define it to the ovarian origin or the pelvic surfaces origin, as we discussed earlier. Now coming to the risk factors. The risk factors in ovarian cancer, the risk decreases with multiparity, women having more number of kids, combined oral contraceptive use, there is a 50% reduction in the risk. Tubal ligation, as we discussed earlier, that before also for the BRCA mutations as well, salpingectomy and hysterectomy. So these women, we consider them on the part of low risk regarding the ovarian cancer. And the main etiological feature could be in these, there is a less number of ovulations. There is a less number of ovulations, because we assume that with each ovulation, the surface epithelium gets more and more damaged in an ovary, in a life cycle of a woman, in a lifetime of a woman with the multiple ovulations, the ovarian epithelium gets more and more damaged, and this further leads to a risk of ovarian malignancy. This is one of our assumptions. As in the case of also use of combined oral contraceptive pills, because we are suppressing the ovulation. And tubal ligation, as we discussed in the very our second slide, that tubal ligation, because the tubes can be the precursor, which we have now come to believe now for the ovarian malignancy. So the women which have all these prophylactic factors are considered to be at the decreased risk of ovarian cancer. And the opposite will be true with the increased risk, as you will see now. Increased risk will be nulliparity with the intrauterine contraceptive device, with endometriosis, cigarette smoking, especially for the mucinous tumors only, and obesity. Obesity, you see, as I discussed you with earlier, that the more estrogenization, with the more estrogenization, which is also a risk factor for ovarian or endometrial malignancies. So you can see for the ovarian cancer, obesity, diet rich in red and processed meats, smoking, alcoholism, early menarche. When there is early menarche and late menopause also, there would be more cycles of ovulation. Nulliparity, more cycles of ovulation. Hormone replacement therapy, more estrogenization. Mutations in BRCA genes and the family history, very important. So BRCA mutation carrier stages, it is a risk factor for high grade serous ovarian cancer. So this you should remember also, that BRCA is a for the high grade serous ovarian cancers. Now coming to the incessant ovulation, as I discussed with you earlier, this theory holds that the repeated damage to the ovarian surface epithelium that occurs at the ovulation increases the risk of mutations that drive the ovarian carcinogenesis. So for the genetic factors in ovarian cancer, 10 to 15% of women with epithelial ovarian cancer have a hereditary predisposition. So what's the risk? 10 to 15%. 10 to 15%. With epithelial ovarian cancer, they have a hereditary predisposition. And women with mutations in BRCA1, BRCA2, and Lynch syndrome have an increased lifetime risk of epithelial ovarian cancer. So please don't forget this, that with BRCA1, BRCA2, and the Lynch syndrome. The lifetime risk in general population, as we discussed earlier, was 1.4%, isn't it? But it rises to 1 in 20. You see, from 1 in 70 to rising to 1 in 20 if one family member is affected. And if two first degree relatives are affected, then it rises up to 40 to 50%. So you see how the risk increases with a sharp incline when there is a family history. So this these figures are very important to remember, that how the hereditary and genetics can affect the risk of ovarian malignancy. So hereditary cancers usually occur around 10 years before sporadic cancer. This is also very important, that not only the hereditary increases the risk of cancer, rather it will bring the malignant change 10 years before the sporadic cancer risk. And they are associated with other cancers as well, with the breast, colon, and rectum also, because of the Lynch syndrome and the BRCA genetics. So breast ovarian cancer syndrome, The most common hereditary cancer is the breast ovarian cancer syndrome, which is known as BRCA, accounting for 90% of the hereditary cancers. And this syndrome is due to a mutation of the tumor suppressor genes BRCA1 and BRCA2. Now, coming to the Lynch syndrome, a hereditary non-polyposis colorectal cancer is associated with endometrial cancer and a 10% lifetime risk of ovarian cancer. This you have, I think, also discussed in medicine as well about the, and surgery also, non-polyposis colorectal cancer. Non-polyposis colorectal cancer associated with endometrial cancer and maybe of the underlying pathophysiology of the same histological subtypes in these organs. And a 10% lifetime risk of ovarian cancer as well in the people with Lynch syndrome. So hereditary ovarian cancer tend to be adenocarcinomas. This I was telling you before, that maybe the histological variant in all of these, the colorectal, the endometrial, and is the adenocarcinoma. So therefore, they have a close association. And they respond better to the platinum chemotherapy. I hope you're not getting bored now. No, you see, because this is all from your textbooks. And this is all the basic and the most important knowledge we should grasp and have a good learning about it. So women who test positive for BRCA mutations are offered risk reducing prophylactic bilateral salpingo-oophorectomy when they have completed their families, and this can usually be performed laparoscopically. Who did this? Yes, the Angelina Jolie. She had a strong family history for her mother and her maternal aunt, and therefore she went through this procedure as well for her prophylaxis. Prophylactic surgery reduces the risk of ovarian cancer by 90% and the premenopausal breast cancer by 50%. So this is a prophylaxis for the breast cancer as well. But it does not eliminate the risk of primary peritoneal cancer. The same thing that the BRCA-associated ovarian cancer is actually originated in the fallopian tube. The COC reduces ovarian cancer risk of about 50% in both BRCA mutation carrier as well. So what's the clinical features for an ovarian cancer? Clinical features, most women with ovarian cancer have symptoms which are, these symptoms are however non-specific and often vague. And this is the main factor that most of the time, unfortunately, we miss the diagnosis for an ovarian malignancy, or rather when we come across it, it's already too late. So this is the main feature because the symptoms are mostly non-specific and often vague. So the symptoms can be increased abdominal girth or blotting, persistent pelvic and abdominal pain, and difficulty eating and feeling full quickly. Other symptoms such as change in bowel habits, urinary and symptoms, backache, irregular bleeding and fatigue. So for the diagnosis investigation, which we should be having would be a transvaginal scan for a pelvic mass, and it should be assessed regarding its size, consistency, the presence of solid elements on a scan, bilaterality, presence of ascites, extra ovarian disease including peritoneal thickening and mantle deposits. An abdominal scan and examination is often required when we feel a fixed hard mass arising from the pelvis, especially that excel masses are also palpable in a slim. So coming to the differential diagnosis, a differential diagnosis of pelvic mass also includes non-epithelial ovarian cancers, tuber ovarian abscesses in cases of pelvic inflammatory disease, endometriomas or fibroids. But in a combination of ascites, a diagnosis of ovarian cancer is highly likely, also of the liver disease in presence of ascites. So about ovarian masses, about 20% in the premenopausal group can be malignant, but in the postmenopausal group, the risk rises up to about 50%. Chest examination is also very important to assess the pleural fluid. Neck and groin nodes should be examined for enlarged nodes. So an important thing would be the tumor markers in ovarian masses. CA125, although not so specific, but it's for the epithelial ovarian tumors, it can be positive in other conditions as well, as we will discuss further. But very high levels can give a definitive help. Also, we have CEA for the mucinous ovarian cancers. HCG for the embryonal carcinoma and the choriocarcinomas, inhibin A or inhibin B, mostly inhibin B for the granulosa cell tumors, lactate dehydrogenase for the dysgerminomas, and alpha fetoproteins for the endodermal sinus tumors and embryonal carcinomas. These tumors are definitely helpful for the diagnosis as well as for the prognosis also. Don't forget, this is very, very important. You should be knowing about tumor markers for the different ovarian neoplasms. So as I told you before, it's the non-specific one, and it's also raised in benign condition as well, like pregnancy, endometriosis, and alcoholic liver disease. But it is raised to certain levels and elevated in over 80% of the epithelial ovarian tumors. An important thing which I would like to also discuss with you is the risk of malignancy index for the ovarian tumors. And this is indicated to be evaluated in the postmenopausal age group. If a lady in a postmenopausal age group presents with an ovarian mass. So we need to know in these cases the menopausal status, which is given its scoring, the pelvic ultrasound features are giving the scoring, and the CA125 level. So these are the three variables which we discuss and which we evaluate while calculating the risk of malignancy index. The CT scan is particularly useful for assessment of extrapelvic disease and for staging. So these are the different, the two modalities, the investigative modalities we are using in the ovarian malignancies in these aspects. And for the MRI, it gives us help for the defining the tissue planes and operability. Other investigations which we need can be electrocardiography, full blood count, X-rays, urea electrolytes, and the liver function tests. We need to have paracentesis and biopsies. Now, for staging the ovarian cancer, always remember, because these days you will going to discuss all the three major malignancies in the female genital tract. I'm discussing with you the ovarian one, then we are going to discuss about the endometrial and also the cervical. So, for the three these malignancies, the staging differs. For the staging of the ovarian cancer, always remember it is clinico-pathological. What is it? It is the clinico-pathological and the surgical assessment. And we use the FIGO classification and the FIGO staging system. This is very important. It looks to be a difficult one, but it's not a difficult. I will help you in this, that major, first only see about the major things. For the stage one ovarian malignancy, the tumor is limited to the ovaries. On the broader aspect, where we say for the stage one, the tumor is limited to the ovaries. For the stage two, the tumor involves one or more both ovaries with pelvic involvement. So what is it? In the stage two, what is added upon is the pelvic involvement. The stage one only, ovaries. For the stage two, ovary plus pelvis. I think now you will not forget. And then the further sub details you can remember easily. For the stage three, the ovaries, the pelvis, plus retroperitoneal lymphadenopathy. So this is three things which are coming in stage three. Then you will not forget. Ovaries with peritoneal metastasis outside the pelvis and the retroperitoneal lymphadenopathy. In the stage two, with pelvic confinement. In the stage three, outside the pelvis with retroperitoneal lymphadenopathy. This you will not forget now. For stage one, ovaries, stage two, ovaries plus inside the pelvis. Stage three, ovaries plus outside the pelvis with retroperitoneal lymphadenopathy. And for stage four, the stag metastasis is involved. So now the further detail you will, inshallah, remember easily. So again, the diagrammatic representation for 1A, 1B, 1C, 2 involving the pelvis, and then for stage 3, outside the pelvis, you see retroperitoneal lymph nodes are involved. See, retroperitoneal peritoneal deposits are there. And in the stage 4, the stent, you see the lungs, the pleural effusions, they are involved. So there can be a metastatic spread, direct spread, lymphatic spread. And the peritoneal disease can happen. The higher percentage, as we discussed earlier, also the peritoneal involvement and the metastatic spread to the lymph nodes. This is how the ovarian cancer progression happens. From the ovary, you see the progression stage 1, and then 2, and then 3. So coming to the management, the staging is part of the management. So the staging is the part of the management, and the staging happens with the surgery. So after the investigations, then we plan for the surgery. Provided the patient is fit for undergoing the anesthesia, and the surgery remains, as I told you before, for confirmation of our diagnosis, for our staging, and treatment for the epithelial ovarian cancers. And definitely a gynecological oncologist will be of much greater help for us than a gynecologist only. So our main objective is to stage the disease and to remove all the visible tumor. This is the main objective of the surgery. Okay. Don't forget, most of the time just ask you revival questions in your university questions, that what is our objective of doing a surgery in an ovarian malignancy. So our main purpose is to stage the disease and to remove all the visible tissue. As much as ovarian cancer is removed, it is important that the most important prognostic factor is that no residual disease following laparotomy is left. A vertical incision is required to gain access to all areas of the abdomen. So for the abdominal incision, we are going to have a vertical incision. Ascites or the peritoneal washings are then sampled. This is the stepwise which we are going to do in the staging laparotomy. This is the question which is asked from you again and again. What you are going to do in a staging laparotomy? A vertical incision is given. First of all, the ascites or the peritoneal washings are sampled. And then total abdominal hysterectomy is performed with mastectomy also. Further debulking may be required, possibly including the resection of the bowel, peritoneal stripping, splenectomy in order to remove the tumor in advanced cases. Lymph node resection is important, and complete debulking to no visible disease varies from 40 to 80% of cases. So this is the radical surgery for ovarian cancer. What is it? We have removed the uterus, the bladder, part of the bladder tumor, cervix, sigmoid, distal colon, even cul-de-sac tumor also. So this was the radical surgery. Maximum debulking has been done. Often in advanced epithelial ovarian tumors, there is diffuse spread of the disease throughout the abdominal cavity, making the surgical clearance of the tumor very difficult. As you can see in this picture, see? This is the spread on all the peritoneal surfaces, on the surface of the guts as well. So now the removal is quite difficult. You see, this is how it has spread. In the young patients, now, even in the epithelial tumors, in the young patients, in the earlier stage, like 1B to 1C, we can offer fertility sparing surgery. It should be the aim. So in these cases, what is a fertility sparing surgery? We can have a unilateral self-angiofectomy, a mastectomy, peritoneal biopsies, and pelvic aortic node dissections, and a medial sampling to exclude a synchronous tumor. It is also done with the case of borderline tumors. Okay. Now, if the patients are unfit for surgery, then what we are going to do? If a patient is unfit or unwilling to have a surgery, or if preoperative assessment indicates that the complete debulking is unlikely to be achievable, a primary chemotherapy may be offered. This is where we are giving the primary chemotherapy. You should be knowing the indications for a primary chemotherapy. If a patient is unwilling, he's unfit, the disease has already spread much further, so we are going to offer a primary chemotherapy. If the patient responds to the chemotherapy, then interval surgery can be planned after 3 cycles. And what is the aim of that interval surgery? It's a second loop surgery. It's a planned laparotomy at the end of chemotherapy, and the main function is to assess and resect any residual disease where the patient is fit enough. And also, if the stage is found to be 1A or 1B on your second local laparotomy, then chemotherapy may be withheld. So this is the purposes which a second local laparotomy can help us out. So for 1C, the role of chemotherapy is a bit uncertain, but post-operative chemotherapy, as with all other stages of epithelial ovarian cancer, is being given. For advanced ovarian cancer, surgery plus platinum-based chemotherapy is our mainstay, and the aim of the surgery is to complete optimal cytoreduction. So we are giving the platinum compounds with paclitaxel, and most regimes are given on an outpatient basis and 3 weeks apart for 6 cycles. Platinum compounds can arrest all the cell replication. Carboplatin is now the main platinum compound used. It is less renal toxic and it causes less nausea than cisplatin, but it is equally as effective. So today, in these days, the carboplatin is of our main helpful measure. Now, what are the prognostic factors in ovarian cancer after our management? Then how is the prognosis? Definitely the prognosis will depend upon what was the earlier stage of the disease. Now, what is the volume of the residual disease? What was the post-surgery histological type? What was the grade of the tumor? And what was the age of the presentation? So definitely these are all the very important prognostic factors. Don't forget them, have a clear learning about them. What's the prognostic factors in ovarian cancer? Now coming to the sex cord stromal tumors. This we have finished now with the epithelial evertine tumors because these account for about 80% of the ovarian malignancy. So we discussed them in very detail. Now we are going to discuss about the sex cord stromal tumors. These are about 10% of the tumors, and the main feature is that they are hormone producing. And the granulocytic cell tumor account among 70% of the sex cord stromal tumors. They can produce estrogen. Androgen production can also be present in the sertilized cell or sertile lighting tumors. These can have the features of precocious puberty, abnormal menstrual bleeding, and increased risk of endometrial cancers because of the increased secretion of the hormones, maybe the underlying reason. So the peak incidence is around the age of menopause, but the juvenile granulocytic cell tumors can appear in the younger girls as well even. These can appear as large pelvic masses and may cause torsion and hemorrhage also. Not like the epithelial ovarian tumor where we encountered about the diffuse masses. So sertile lighting cells can produce androgens. Patient can have pelvic masses and virilizations, and they can be common symptoms of amenorrhea, deep voice, and hirsutism. Really, these tumors can produce renin and causing hypertension as one of the features as well also. So unilateral ovarian masses are present mostly with the sex cord stromal tumors. Macroscopically, they show yellow solid areas of and hemorrhage as well because of the steroid production. And for them, as we discussed earlier also, the tumor marker is most of the time inhibin. Okay, so it's of both of diagnostic and prognostic value. So what's the treatment? Depending upon the patient's age and wish. In a younger patient, we can definitely offer them fertility sparing surgery, and definitely endometrial sampling and staging is sufficient. In older age group, full surgical staging is required. Recurrence is can occur after a long time, and therefore a long-term follow-up is required, and there is no effective chemotherapy regime for the sex cord stromal tumors. Now coming to the germ cell tumors. Germ cell tumors also account for about 10% of the ovarian tumors. These are the malignant germ cell tumors which occur mainly in the young women and account for approximately 10%. They're derived from the primordial germ cells. So this was the third variant or the third histological feature of a normal ovary, of the germ cells. And within the ovary, and because of this, may contain any cell type. Because of the germ cells, we remember that there are three germ cell types. So they can account for any of the endodermal, mesodermal, or mesenchymal layers. The emphasis of the management is based mainly on the fertility preserving surgery and chemotherapy. Now for the germ cell tumors, chemotherapy is helpful, but not as in the case was sex cord stromal tumors. Please remember these differences, okay? So what we remember now that for the sex cord stromal tumors and the germ cell tumors in the earlier age group with the earlier disease, fertility preserving surgery is recommended, and chemotherapy is helpful in cases of germ cell tumors. And what was the benign counterpart for them was the dermoid cysts, which were the mature cystic teratomas. So for the symptoms of the germ cell tumors, the most common presenting symptom is the pelvic mass. And 10% present acutely with torsion or hemorrhage. This was true in cases of benign teratomas as well, and also in cases of sex postural tumors. The AIDS incidence may present during pregnancy also. So 70% of the germ cell tumors are stage 1. They spread by lymphatics or they spread is by blood-borne. And the first type among them is of the dysgerminomas. Dysgerminomas can account for 50% of all germ cell tumors, which was the most common among the sex cord tumors, granulosa cell tumors. So among the germ cell tumors, dysgerminoma was having a higher proportion. They are bilateral in 20% of cases. And for them, the tumor marker is occasionally they secrete the human chorionic gonadotrophic. Now, the immature teratomas. Immature teratomas account for 50 to 20% of malignant germ cell tumors. They are classified as mature or immature depending upon the grading of the neural tissue present. One third of the teratomas create alpha fetal proteins. For dysgerminoma, the tumor markers was human chorionic gonadotrophin. For the immature teratomas, the tumor marker is alpha fetal proteins. And squamous cell carcinoma is their malignant histological subtype most of the time. Now, the third variant of the germ cell tumor, the first one was dysgerminoma, second one was immature teratomas. And third one is the non-gestational choriocarcinoma. What is the choriocarcinoma? Yes, it's a malignant potential which is happening in the molar pregnancy. But that was a complication related to pregnancy. But in non-pregnant state, even non-gestational choriocarcinoma can happen. Therefore, the name is non-gestational. It's not related to pregnancy. It can happen in unmarried and young girls as well. So they are, but they are very rare, usually presenting in the young girls and with irregular bleeding and with the tumor marker of HCG. So human chorionic gonadotrophin, this can be a variant in a tumor marker with a non-gestational choriocarcinoma. So the treatment is surgery, which is tailored to suit the patient, as most women presenting with malignant germ cell tumors are of reproductive age. So therefore, the fertility sparing treatment may be preferred. Intraoperative frozen sections may be required to assess the nodal state. Post-operative chemotherapy depends upon the stage of the disease. Okay, so post-operative chemotherapy depends upon the stage of the disease. Stage 1 dysgerminomas and low-grade teratomas are treated by surgery alone, and the 5-year survival rate is good enough, around 90%. So for the remainder of tumors and for the patients with disease outside the ovary, chemotherapy is given. The variants of the germ cell tumors. The most common regime used is the combination, and the germ cell tumor is the BEP regime. Bleomycin, etoposide, and cisplatin. Now you will not forget, for the epithelial ovarian tumors, carboplatin was the good enough regime. And for germ cell tumors, we have the BEP regime. These are also given in the courses of 3 to 4 treatments and 3 weeks apart. And the cure rates are around 90%. For the clinical features of germ cell tumors, they are mostly large solid ovarian masses that are rapidly growing. MRI can be helpful to assess the morphology, particularly within the teratoma. The scanning of the abdomen also gives us knowledge about the liver and the lymph nodes, and that all the patients should have an X-ray to exclude pulmonary metastasis. Now, for the endodermal sinus yolk sac tumors, part of the germ cell tumor, these are second most common germ cell tumors, apart from the dysgerminoma, and accounting for 15% of the total. And they secrete alpha fetal protein as their tumor marker. They are also large swollen masses. And spread of the endodermal sinus tumor is a late event and is usually to the lungs. In the patient, and I have seen this particular case is appearing in very young women. And unfortunately, we lost that woman. So 90% are usually present in the first year following the diagnosis. Salvage chemotherapy is very good success rates. Now, what are the key learning points in our lecture today? Ovarian cancer tend to present late with advanced disease because symptoms are non-specific. This is the thing I told you earlier also, because of the unfortunate thing that the symptoms are non-specific, we approach very late for the help. And by the time, mostly they have gone to a very advanced stage. Screening has not yet proven effective using the tumor markers or the transvaginal scans. They can be helpful to some extent, but they are not our main screening tools. As is in case of cervical cancer, we have screening in the form of pap smears. But it's not the case that we find any screening tool in ovarian cancers or malignancies. While we are comparing the malignancies of the lower genital, the main three malignancies of the lower genital tract. Treatment is based on removing all the tumors surgically, combined with platinum-based chemotherapy. So prognosis is stage dependent. For the stage one disease, it has about 80 to 90% 5-year survival rate. Whereas for stage three, you see how much it drops. It has become to 30% 5-year survival rate. Sex cord stromal tumors usually present with endocrine effects due to excess secretion of estrogen or androgens. For the germ cell tumors, as most of the time they appear in young women, so they are often cured by the fertility preserving surgery. So thank you very much for your attention. I hope, although it seems to be quite difficult, or rather I would say lengthy portion of your malignancies of genital tract, but my dear students, very important. Ovarian malignancy will come across many times. You will come across of the undiagnosed clinical cases around you many times, and if you have this knowledge and background in your mind, I think you can help many of the people around you, and it will definitely also help you in your exams also. Please closer look, have again and again on these lectures, keep your notes ready, keep a thorough evaluation from your textbooks as well, and inshallah I hope you will not have any difficulty in learning and having a knowledge for this topic. Thank you very much.